we would start with a welcome by the President, Mr. Kiran Karnik. First of all, a bouquet to greet our annual speaker. Sir, can I request you to?
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this annual lecture. This is, as many of you who have been here in the past few years know, our flagship event where we get the most eminent and most interesting speakers from around the country to come and share with us their perspective and their thoughts on things that are really important and critical. As you recall, just the last 3 years, we've had a galaxy of eminent people. We had former President Abdul Kalam, and then we had Dr. Raghuram Rajan, former Governor of the Reserve Bank. And last year, we had Sonam Wangchuk, who's doing exceedingly interesting and innovative work all over the country in education, but also in other spheres, and many of you might have listened to the things he's doing, particularly in Ladakh. This year, keeping with that kind of level of eminence and achievement, I'm delighted that we can welcome Kiran Mazumdar-Shaw. Thank you, Kiran, for being here with us today. She is, as you already know, a very, very respected person who's been a pioneer in the biotechnology space in India and around the world has won wide recognition and acclaim. She's been listed as one of the 100 most influential people in the world by Time magazine. And there's a whole host of awards, recognitions, listings, which I won't go into. I'd rather spend the time listening to her than listening about her. You heard some of her views, I know, in this video, so I don't want to repeat that. But I want to say that she's been somebody who's really been a role model, not just for women, and I heard the last part of that, but a role model indeed for all those who want to be entrepreneurs and entrepreneurs in science and do this in a difficult environment and yet be successful. So she's really flown the flag of India high in not just biotechnology, but how science is used in industry and where and what you can do with that. So you're going to hear some interesting aspects of that part of it from her. Want to also mention that she's done a lot of other things besides being involved in science. She's been chairperson of the Indian Institute of Management in Bangalore. She's done a lot of other things, but the one thing I do want to mention is that she's one of the earliest, the second from India, if I remember right, on the giving part. And as you know, this is a pledge which was initiated by Warren Buffett and Bill and Melinda Gates, where people who are wealthy commit to giving away more, a majority of their wealth, more than half their wealth, to social causes. So a successful entrepreneur who's not only doing well, but doing good, and you know, may her tribe increase. With that very brief sort of introduction, I can go on, but I don't want to. I want to hand over the floor to Kiran and spend time listening to her. The format we'll follow is the standard one. She'll speak, and then at the end, we'll keep some time for questions. I'd like the questions to be brief so we can get as many of them as possible. And we aim to wind up by around 8:30. In fact, we'll try and make it sharp at 8:30. So thank you once again for being here. And may I now invite Kiran Mazumdar-Shaw to share with us her perspectives and deliver the IHC lecture for the year. Kiran?
Thank you so much, my namesake. I'm absolutely delighted to be here standing before you and giving this India Habitat Center annual lecture. I know what a privilege it is. I know what an honor it is, and I am humbled. I would also like to acknowledge the Association of Biotechnology-Led Enterprises because they have also supported this endeavor in a big way. I know that this is an association that is really trying to put science and science-led businesses to the fore, and I think this is really something India needs to do in a much bigger way. So, you know, I decided when, you know, Kiran Karnik asked me to give this lecture, I was just thinking to myself, what am I going to speak about? And I must confess that in recent times, I've been very fascinated by data science and what it can do for our economy, for our businesses, for our day-to-day lives, and how it is impacting us. And therefore, I decided to talk about the strategic importance of data sciences in research and innovation. And I must confess that whilst I was actually writing this talk, I learned a great deal more about data science and the power of data science. So let me start by basically saying that data is king. In 2012, the International Data Center projected that the digital universe will reach 40 zettabytes by 2020. This was based on the assumption that 1.7 megabytes of new information will be created every second for every human being on the planet in 2020. I mean, it's just a mind-boggling thought. And IDC realized that its projection was actually on the conservative side, as its current forecast says that the global data sphere will grow to 163 zettabytes by 2025. To give you an idea of the kind of size we are talking about, one zettabyte is a trillion gigabytes, which is roughly equal in size to 43 billion Blu-ray discs or 250 billion DVDs. This unimaginably vast amount of digital information can enable humanity to do many of the things that were previously considered impossible. Data science, which allows us to make sense of big data, as the jargon goes, is helping us find relationships between distinct kinds of information, thus generating new insights, creating new knowledge, and leading to breakthrough innovation. Big data can be the most important instrument for transformative social change the world has ever seen. It is no surprise then that the most powerful and valuable corporations in the world today are the ones that deal in data. The five US tech titans, Google, Microsoft, Amazon, Apple, and Facebook, each have a market cap in excess of $500 billion. And collectively, they're worth nearly $3.3 trillion, which is larger than the size of the Indian economy. Data is quickly becoming the 21st century's economic fuel, replacing oil as an essential resource for the global economy, and thereby the focus of intense struggle to control it. Just as in the past, oil was something all big economies wanted to control, today it's data, as you can see from the recent kind of discussions and controversies that are arising, everyone wants to control data. We stand at the dawn of the data age, where data will be the lifeblood of our rapidly expanding digital existence, and the new raw material of business, and economic input at par with capital and labor. IDC forecasts that 20% of data produced in 2025 will belong to data sets that run the risk of being disruptive or even life-threatening if unavailable at any moment. Just think about that. It could be life-threatening if certain kinds of data were unavailable at any moment. So let's talk about the data network effect. Unorganized data is useless information. But when it is analyzed, structured, and interpreted, it becomes valuable knowledge. Data science, or the study of databases and data sets, epitomizes what Professor Abraham Flexner of Princeton University refers to as the usefulness of useless knowledge. Data has been collected and collated for centuries, but in the absence of computing power, it remained archived as historical artifacts. For example, the Swedish town of Uppsala had diligently and meticulously collected health records of its citizens for over 40 years. The power of this data was only realized in the 1990s when computational analysis of this rich database provided familial and biochemical markers to cardiac diseases. Likewise, a company called Decode Genetics created a large genomic database of the uniquely homogeneous Icelandic population in 2001, which was translated into genetic risk factors associated with several diseases and a gene discovery engine that would drive research and innovation in the future. It is these kind of data centers that are being created across businesses and across industries. Have you ever wondered why Uber is valued at almost $100 billion? Is it only because it is a successful taxi aggregator? Certainly not. That's just part of the story. Uber's astronomical valuation is also a factor of its ownership of the biggest pool of data about supply, that is, car drivers and demand, that is, passengers for personal transportation. Similarly, Tesla is not just a maker of fancy electric cars. The company's latest models collect huge amounts of data, which allow it to optimize its self-driving algorithms and then update the software accordingly. By the end of 2016, the firm had gathered 1.3 billion miles worth of driving data. Data that can be leveraged to make better real-time decisions and navigate real-world environments. Algorithms are increasingly self-teaching. The more fresh data they are fed, the better it is as it learns from input data and adapts the output to respond intelligently to new data, kicking off the data network effect. A powerful virtuous cycle of innovation where data is used to attract more users who then generate more data, which helps to improve services, which attracts even more users. For example, the more users comment or like a Facebook post, the more it learns about those users and the better targeted the ads on news feeds become. Similarly, the more people search on Google, the better its search results turn out. Or the more buyers and sellers using a marketplace like eBay, the more efficient it becomes. As the world becomes increasingly hyper-connected and everything and everyone becomes interconnected into a single global network, the data network effect will expand. It will allow data science to identify patterns across the data that would normally escape even the brightest experts amongst us. It will begin to open new doors to the future. So let me for a minute talk about this very interesting company called Mu Sigma. Indian entrepreneurs have been anticipating opportunities from a big data explosion for over a decade. One of the first people to identify this opportunity was 28-year-old Dheeraj Rajaram, who quit his job in the US and came back to set up a small data analytics company called Mu Sigma in Bangalore in 2004. And as a startup entrepreneur, I think I always get very excited by these kind of companies who look at opportunities ahead of time. Mu Sigma signed up its first customer, which was none other than Microsoft, in 2005 to provide data analytics services that would help the software behemoth make day-to-day business decisions based on hard data rather than gut feel. Today, Mu Sigma counts 140 of the Fortune 500 companies as its clients and employs over 1,000 data scientists. As an early entrant into the fast-growing analytics space, Mu Sigma was able to sign up marquee names like Sequoia Capital, General Atlantic Partners, MasterCard, and Fidelity as investors. Thanks to its expertise on data analytics, Mu Sigma is valued at over $1 billion today. Now let's talk about data overload and quantum computing. Zettabytes of data demand exponential computing power or quantum computing, as conventional computing is akin to try and drink from a fire hydrant. Unlike binary digital computing, quantum computation involves quantum bits that can apply complex algorithms and integer factorization to deliver solutions at speeds that are orders of magnitude faster than classical computers. Simply put, quantum computing takes advantage of the strange ability of subatomic particles to exist in more than one state at any time, which allows it to store more multiplexed information and thereby perform operations more quickly using less energy than classical computers. Google and IBM are leading the way in developing quantum computers, claiming quantum supremacy to develop credible and reliable artificial intelligence-based solutions by 2020. Last year, a team of Google and NASA scientists created what they called a D-wave quantum computer that was 100 million times faster than a conventional computer. Just think about that. But moving quantum computing to an industrial scale is very difficult. IBM, however, claims that it is confident it will deliver quantum computers with 50 qubits at commercial scale within a few years. If artificial intelligence is to deliver on its stated promise of transforming the digital world, it certainly cannot do so without quantum computing. In the near term, AI will rely on machine learning based on first-generation quantum computing and thereby address obvious opportunities in driverless vehicles, perhaps robotics and weather forecasting. Next-gen quantum computing will have the potential to replace human intervention in ways that are unimaginable even today. So let me now really focus on data science in the context of drug research, which is really my area. Creating a new drug from scratch is an expensive and time-consuming process. First, researchers must identify a potential therapeutic target. Then a drug that acts on that target must be designed, purified, and tested both on cells in a dish and in living animals. In order to be approved, this new drug must meet rigorous safety specifications and pass through highly controlled phases of human testing. It could take up to a decade for a new drug to complete the lab-to-market journey and cost over $2.5 billion. With a 1 in 10 success rate, the global pharmaceutical industry is looking at data science for enhancing the probability of success and thereby shortening timelines. Data science is today enabling the pharmaceutical industry to throw off the shackles of the conventional one drug, one target, one disease model of healthcare innovation, which is inefficient, expensive, and time-consuming. Whilst it is true that the cost of bringing a new drug to the market is enormous, it is also true that the astronomical price tags for revolutionary new treatments are unsustainable. The US FDA recently approved the first gene therapy, Luxturna, which will hit the market for a mind-boggling price tag of $50,000 per treatment per dose, and at $850,000, at $425,000 for each eye, this treatment for a rare type of inherited blindness will be the most expensive drug on the market. Moreover, despite these medical breakthroughs, we are unable to anticipate off-target side effects caused by all drugs. Additionally, we are unable to explain the presence of the large numbers of non-responders to many drugs. Drug research today is therefore relying on multiplex data sets to answer and solve many of these medical challenges. An illustration of this is provided by a company called Bugworks, a data-driven biotech startup in Bangalore, incubated at CCAMP at the National Center for Biological Sciences. This company is developing next-generation antibiotics to fight drug resistance. Antibiotics in the past have been happy accidental discoveries and have remained incremental innovations over the decades. It is noteworthy that since 1962, when fluoroquinolone was discovered as the next-gen antibiotic, we have not seen any breakthrough innovations to deal with large unmet needs in infection control, which still remains one of the highest causes of mortality in the developing world. Bugworks has focused its efforts to leverage and combine multiple data sets from a vast pool of clinical, genomic, pharmacological, and even epidemic data to develop algorithms that can design novel antibiotics to combat wide-ranging infections and even superbugs. Data science is therefore ushering in the next wave of drug innovation by promising to transform every stage of the new drug discovery and development process. Bioinformatics, a specialized branch of data science, is helping incorporate knowledge derived from genomics, proteomics, and other biological disciplines into drug discovery and drug design in order to come up with revolutionary ideas for new molecules. However, we are talking of a humongous amount of data here. If printed on standard office paper and stacked, the raw sequencing data of just one patient's genome would top an 80-storied building. The quest to sequence the first genome was a massive undertaking. Between 1990 and the publication of a working draft in 2001, more than 200 scientists joined forces in a $3 billion effort to read the roughly 3 billion base pairs of DNA that comprise our genetic material. Fortunately, genome sequencing costs have plummeted in the last decade from almost $10 million in 2007 to close to $1,000 today, cheap enough to put the cost of sequencing all of an individual's DNA on par with many routine medical tests. Doctors and researchers can today study an individual's genome without spending an astronomical sum. The availability of genetic information, together with other phenotypic as well as medical information, is helping identify new drug targets by linking particular genes and their products to individual diseases. In addition to genomic data, other omics data have moved into the spotlight. Proteomics and metabolics, as well as epigenetics, and an integrated view of all these disciplines are gaining more and more traction. Also, the impact of lifestyle choices is now starting to be factored in. On the other end of the spectrum, electronic health records and other patient-related information in registries, hospital administration databases, and other payer databases are helping to establish real-world evidence for the effectiveness of a particular medicine and actually helping to play a very important role in pharmacoeconomics. Data analytics is helping predict clinical outcomes, inform clinical trial designs, support evidence of effectiveness, optimize dosing, predict product safety, and evaluate potential adverse event mechanisms. Drug discovery research today is bringing together cross-disciplinary teams comprising biologists, chemists, clinicians, and data scientists. Data scientists draw on their expertise in computer science and statistics to sift through gargantuan virtual databases of molecular and clinical data to zoom in on likely drug candidates that treat key mutations. The Mazumdar-Shaw Center for Translational Research, which I have helped to set up in Bengaluru, is working closely with clinicians at the Mazumdar-Shaw Medical Center to facilitate translational research that will contribute to early detection, diagnosis, and treatment of various human diseases by analyzing the data being generated through patients being treated at the hospital. Close collaboration between the scientific teams of Strand Life Sciences, The Mazumdar-Shaw Center for Translational Research, the Mazumdar-Shaw Medical Center, and the HCG Cancer Hospitals recently led to breakthrough research in cancer detection. It resulted in Strand Life Sciences becoming one of the earliest companies to introduce the revolutionary liquid biopsy technology in India. Liquid biopsy is a paradigm shift as it provides a highly sensitive technique to identify the genetic signature of a person's cancer through a simple blood draw. It helps to create personalized cancer treatment plans for each patient. It can also provide insights to assess if a patient is prone to a relapse and if a person is likely to respond to a therapy or not. Now coming to data science for drug modeling. Designing medicines to target diseases requires knowing what proteins are involved and what their shapes are. Advances in data science are leading to accurate predictions of the interactions between novel drugs and their targets, helping reduce the cost of drug discovery by several orders of magnitude. One of the most critical steps in evaluating any potential medical treatment involves testing its toxicity in animal models. Now, big data is offering a validated alternative to animal tests. In fact, data analytics and machine learning techniques that combine data sets from disparate chemical and biological assays have shown that a virtual model can at times predict toxicity better than traditional animal testing. Data science is also leading to a rethink of the whole clinical development approach and promises to enable faster, safer, and less expensive clinical trials. Pharma companies are now using multiple data sources, including social media and public health databases, and more targeted criteria like genetic information to identify which populations would benefit the most from a planned clinical trial. In silico clinical trials, which involve the use of computer models and simulations in the development of a medicinal product, are gaining popularity. These trials can be executed quickly and for a fraction of the cost of a full-scale live trial. Leveraging advanced data analytics presents a real and significant opportunity for the pharmaceutical industry. A recent McKinsey analysis has shown that operating efficiencies attainable from scaling the impact of advanced analytics range as high as 15 to 30% of EBITDA over 5 years, accelerating to 45 to 75% over a decade, given the potential impact of predictive modeling in discovering and optimizing new blockbuster therapies. In increasingly cost-constrained global healthcare markets, pharma companies that leverage analytics for advanced data-driven decision-making over the next 1 to 3 years will gain decisive advantage over their peers, according to McKinsey. This is a very important slide. It's about repurposing of drugs for new indications. Developing and testing a new anti-cancer drug can cost billions of dollars and take many years of research. However, advanced data analytics is turning up novel relationships in biological data that are impenetrable through ordinary statistical means. Data analytics is also allowing scientists to look at data in a multifaceted way and match drugs with an identified mechanism of action to a particular disease or across different diseases. It is helping researchers find effective anti-cancer medications from the pool of drugs already approved for the treatment of other medical conditions, because these drugs are already known to be safe for humans. These trials could potentially be initiated very quickly, thus cutting a considerable amount of time and money for the process. For example, a computational method to systematically probe massive amounts of open access data to discover new ways to use drugs led to the identification of 4 drugs with cancer-fighting potential last year. A team from the University of California, San Francisco, was able to demonstrate that one of the 4 drugs, an FDA-approved drug called pyruvium pamoate, which is used to treat pinworms, could shrink hepatocellular carcinoma, a type of liver cancer in mice. This cancer, which is associated with underlying liver disease and cirrhosis, is the 2nd largest cause of cancer deaths around the world, yet it has no effective treatment. Similarly, a novel bioinformatics approach in 2016 enabled a team of researchers to find that an antimicrobial drug, pentaminide, which is described for pneumonia, can be used to treat patients with advanced kidney cancer. There is also great excitement surrounding a promising new use of metformin, a drug that has been historically used in the mainstay of type 2 diabetes management. Emerging data shows a link between the use of metformin with a decrease in the risk of developing cancer and a reduced cancer-related mortality. India is fast gaining global recognition for the quality of its data scientists who enable evidence-based decision-making. The ability of our data analysts has led to the emergence of decision sciences at the intersection of technology, business, and math, thus creating a new man-machine ecosystem. The exponential growth in the fields of artificial intelligence and machine learning is leading to a huge demand for highly skilled professionals. Over the last 1 year, the number of analytics jobs in India has more than doubled. As more data analytics projects get outsourced to India due to a dearth of such skills across the world, we are likely to see a boom in this field in the years ahead. India has an opportunity to create integrated databases that cut across genomic, molecular, chemical, clinical, and even medical, administrative, and insurance data. Additionally, plant genomics and plant chemistries can provide another powerful multiplex database. India is home to more than 1 billion people, consisting of more than 4,500 anthropologically well-defined populations. India thus offers wide genetic variance. Studies have shown that genetic diversity in India is up to 4 times greater than that found in Europe. This offers a huge opportunity for India to create and mine a rich source of genomic information. In fact, smart mining of genetic data can help India transform the disadvantage of a huge disease burden into a competitive advantage by capturing and analyzing this information. Moreover, India is one of the richest countries in the world as regards genetic resource of medicinal and aromatic plants. It constitutes 11% of total known world flora through its total landmass, though its total landmass occupies only 2% of the globe. India has 15 agroclimatic zones, 47,000 different plant species. Medicinal plants as a group comprise approximately 15,000 species and account for about 32% of all the higher flowering plant species of India. Out of these, the Indian system of medicine have identified 1,500 medicinal plants, of which 500 species are generally used in the preparation of drugs. IT-enabled data mining can provide India with a huge competitive advantage in bringing innovative plant-based therapies to the world. Bio-IT, being data agnostic, can also play a powerful role in other segments of biotechnology, including agriculture, environmental, and industrial biotechnology, and much more. The Indian government can play an enabling role in incentivizing the creation and mining of these databases by giving in tax breaks to companies involved in such activities. Such a move will give a fillip to the Digital India story, as it will allow Indian companies to intelligently leverage data to come up with high-value products for global markets. The recent economic survey 2017-18 for the first time included a chapter on the transformative potential of science and technology. It called for a doubling of efforts and expenditure in R&D with a mission mode focus on genomics, mathematics, dark matter, energy storage systems, cyber-physical systems, and agriculture. Integral to this must be big data analytics. It called for the private sector to play a key role in these efforts. If so, then data science-led R&D and businesses that rely on data analytics must be treated as priority sectors for both grants and lending. Gene sequencers, quantum computers, and other big data infrastructure must be invested in and provided with tax incentives in order to build capacity and scale. So let me, in conclusion, quote Sir William Osler, who is known as the father of modern medicine, who has articulated a bold vision for medical science. He said, "To wrest from nature the secrets which have perplexed philosophers in all ages, to track to their sources the causes of disease, to correlate the vast stores of knowledge, that they are quickly available for the prevention and cure of disease. These are our ambitions." More than a century later, we seem to be on the verge of realizing Osler's vision as artificial intelligence, fueled by the exponential rise in big data, becomes a powerful extension of human intelligence. Innovation is the collective compound interest of human ingenuity. By enabling new ways of thinking and amplifying human innovation, data sciences is enabling exponential rather than linear growth in human knowledge to unleash the potential of breakthrough innovation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kiran, for that very wide-ranging and phenomenal look at what data sciences can do, how it can contribute, what it's done already, and the potential to do so much more in certainly in the areas that you talked of, which are crucial to the health of each one of us and indeed the whole country, but clearly extending beyond that and to look at data as you said, the new oil, the mining of data, the kind of riches it can provide. We have some time for questions, and I'd like to throw the floor open for questions. Lots of hands. Please make the questions sharp and brief. We have some time, but I don't want to give enough time to her to answer them.
Sure. Thank you, ma'am. My name is Professor Deepak Gaur. I'm from the School of Biotechnology, Jawaharlal Nehru University. I had the pleasure of meeting you this morning at the Rashtrapati Bhavan. And the whole essence of the meeting today and what you've talked about is innovation. Now, I actually heard you once in Walk the Talk with Shikhar Gupta say that one of the problems that one is facing in clinical development within India is the lack of permissions to do clinical trials. I myself am interested in malaria vaccines and I've been working on that. So my question, madam, is that is the climate in India changed in towards, you know, with the is there a favorable climate to do clinical trials? Have you seen any difference? And if so, are you actually planning to do something to impress upon our government to allow this? Because without human trials, we really cannot innovate medicines and new drugs. Thank you.
No, absolutely. I think there are winds of change, and I think I feel very optimistic because I think I clearly see that the regulatory scenario is changing in India. People are certainly, you know, the CDSCO is certainly very seized of this problem. In fact, we are seeing that clinical trials are easing up. In fact, this afternoon after the Rashtrapati Bhavan meeting, we actually had a very good meeting with the Drugs Controller General of India. And he was himself assuring us that, you know, the whole clinical trial, scenario in India is going to really change rapidly because they want to foster innovation. So I'm sure that you will find things are changing in a very rapid way for the better.
Thank you. Yes, the lady here, please.
First of all, it's an honor to hear you in person finally. My question to you is that when we think about data in terms of patient data and then slowly moving towards genomic data, The concerns that arise are safety of the data, and what do you think are those in terms of the Indian context? Because we are yet a very poor nation, and we can be exploited.
Well, you know that there is a lot of technology today to encrypt data. So I don't think we should really worry about the safety of the data. If you have, there are a lot of technologies today that actually encrypt data, that anonymize data. And I think that's the kind of system we need to follow when we are looking at big data. You know, we're looking at huge amounts of data. There's no question of, you know, being able to kind of have personalized readouts of that data. We're looking at patterns. We're looking at data mining, which really is very agnostic to personal data. So I think that's the kind of system we need to follow when we are looking at these kind of big data analytics.
Gentlemen there, please. Yes.
Thank you, sir. And again, I must compliment you for a very interesting lecture, taking us to the future. I have two. I am a physicist. My name is Saxena. On quantum computing and entangled states and all of that which you had mentioned, I have a very genuine concern that is it that we are going to do away because of the data analytics and the power of computing? Are we going to do away with the clinical trials and we'll just start inventing drugs out of simulations in the machines? That is one question. And the other is with this advanced data analytics, are we going to manipulate the genes and create situations where there are no diseases whatsoever? Thank you.
Well, I think you're talking about a very idealistic, futuristic scenario. But I would say that I think you need to use analytics to validate and support a lot of what you're doing through clinical trials. Because you know that even today, many companies fail not because the drug doesn't work, but because the clinical design has been flawed, faulty. Many times, you know, drugs fail for many reasons, because the statistical analysis is not correct, because you haven't really gone about data analysis or data analytics in the right way. So I think it'll certainly have a huge impact on improving drug design and drug development. And I think that's what will be the near-term application of data analytics and data science. In the future, I think you will be able to reduce the size of the clinical trials and rely on very, very important data sets to really evaluate drugs. I think that's what the ultimate target is going to be. How do you really, validate how drugs, new drugs work with very, very few patients? I don't think we really want to really expose a huge number of patients all the time. So I think the trick is, how do you make sure that a small cohort of patients will give you enough data, which gives you the same kind of data that you can generate by doing the same trial on thousands of patients? I think that's really the crux of the matter. And as for, you know, the gene, the genetic modifications and gene therapies that you're talking about, I certainly hope that, you know, any genetic malfunctions or genetic mutations that cause diseases can actually quickly be corrected. I think that should be. This gene editing is a huge opportunity, but it takes a lot of bioinformatic knowledge and analytics knowledge to actually be able to even do that. I mean, today we are all talking about CAR T cells and that kind of technology, but it's a very personalized medicine technology. But believe me, the amount of informatics that goes into just developing those CAR T cells is huge. So it's not simple.
And any concerns about gene manipulation, Kiran?
No, I think, you know, if you need to modify genes to save people, I think saving lives comes above everything else.
Back then we move forward. Somebody had a question there? Yes, please.
Good evening. My name is Vinayak Dalmia. Thank you for your talk. I have a more mundane question. How practical, in your experience, is it for a non-science person to start a science business or a science-based business?
You know, personally, I believe that if you imbibe yourself, if you spend a lot of time in a science-led business, it's easier for people to actually pick up what the business is all about. But you know, to start a business and to build it up, it's always, I think, useful if you understand the science of the business. So the business of science is pretty important. And I think I have learned that people who succeed in many of these companies that are beginning to show success are people who understand the deep science behind those businesses.
Up here in front, please.
Dr. Sarji Dudeja. Madam, I was involved in the fertility control vaccine. There we had on monkeys also. Later on, I was in AIMS. My PhD on muscular dystrophy, which is genetic disorder. The way we are talking about genetic editing, do you think it will be affordable? Because our country is such a poor country where affordability is a big issue. So how this whole system will be taken care?
Well, I think basically we need to really invest in this kind of innovation. You know, we have scale in this country. So once you have scale, because of the sheer size of our populations, there is an element of affordability through just economies of scale. But if you start only looking at doing something in isolation, it's going to be very, very expensive. I think we have to you know, go about all this pursuit in a way that we want to basically address unmet needs. And once you address unmet needs, you know, what is affordability? What is cost? It all depends on how you define that.
Hi, very nice lecture. And my name is Sakshi Talwar. My question is that what was the biggest challenge you faced as a woman entrepreneur when you were first starting out?
So I think, you know, every woman faces credibility challenges because society has a gender bias. So I think there is a real credibility issue that any woman faces in any field that she operates in. And I think it's really about overcoming that credibility and perception bias. It's really perception. So when you talk about credibility in the case of women, I think it's a perception hurdle that you need to overcome. And I think in my talk, I think I did mention that, you know, you have to overcome these perception hurdles by just focusing on what you need to do and delivering successfully on what you're doing.
I know there are questions this side too, so we start from here and then move across here. If we come across here, here.
I'm Professor Ramesh Goyal, Vice Chancellor of DPSRU. The India, as you rightly pointed out, diversity in India, one of the diversity is also about the diseases. Various diseases are diversified. And very important opportunity, data mining, but at the same time, data creation also comes through genomics analysis of various blood samples, whether it is a biobanking, whether it is the diagnostics. And unfortunately, what I feel is that probably many things are being outsourced, like HLA typing or their PGS, PGDs, many times they are outsourced. Is it possible that it is not, this also should be promoted to see that our diversity and our wealth is better utilized?
Well, you'll be interested to know that a lot of these services are now being offered in our country. But they, you know, they are being offered in many centers, but they need to be scaled up. Many other centers may outsource it, but I certainly believe that many centers I know of are actually giving you a lot of this kind of support and services. So it can easily be done. I mean, next-gen sequencing, Strand, Life Sciences, you know, Dr. Vijay Chandru is next door, next sitting just very close to you. And he's doing a whole amount of next-gen sequencing. There are many, many companies doing next-gen sequencing. You know, those are just techniques. I mean, it's just investing in the infrastructure. That's the whole issue. And I think once you create that kind of ecosystem, you'll find that, you know, it'll happen very naturally. So it's a sort of a chicken and egg situation. I think in a technology hub like Bangalore, we've worked it out. You know, we no longer say, will it, what will happen if so, and what ifs and buts. We don't do that. We just go ahead and do it, and then everything seems to happen. So I really think you just need to do that.
Good evening, madam. I really feel very nice coming here and attending your lecture. And this is of the evening which may transform my life by your knowledge share. I want to know about this liquid biopsy you have mentioned. Is it available for the common people?
Yes, and I may want to. I think Dr. Vijay Chandru is right here, who has developed the whole liquid biopsy. And it's being used in many, many hospitals. I mean, we've already rolled it out in a big way in quite a few hospitals, in not, maybe not in Delhi, but certainly in the south, in Bangalore, we certainly are using it in many hospitals, and it's a great, great intervention.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Yes, please.
I myself, Ravinder Prasad, my question to you, ma'am, in big data are used either a state level or national level in making policy making. India has so many problems like poverty, malnutrition, yeah, in the medical field, or policy maker, or bureaucrat, or maybe politician. Are they using really this big data in making policy making?
Unfortunately not. Well, they can. Let me put it this way. I think they can and they should. And I think that's the way we'll get better policies and a better understanding of what is it that causes malnutrition or what is it that's causing a drought or a famine or whatever it is. So I think data needs to be leveraged for sure.
Vijay, did you want to add something on liquid biopsy?
But maybe you should.
You want to?
So liquid biopsy is, the idea is you're looking for cell-free DNA and the tumor signal from a blood sample. Today, the state of the art is that we're able to monitor a cancer patient for recurrence and remission by taking blood samples periodically. And if the tumor recurs, you will know far ahead of it actually being imaged in a scan, right? The real sort of holy grail with liquid biopsy is when you can screen for early stage cancer. And that, we believe, is somewhere between maybe 3 to 5 years away before you can actually introduce it as part of, say, an annual checkup for high-risk populations and catch cancer early. Because catching cancer early is really the best way to cure.
Thank you, Vijay. Someone out here, please. Yes, please. I can see this side. Yes, I'll come across to all of you.
Good evening, Madam. Tirthankar Goyal. So very, very good speech by you. So what are the niche market for this data analysis, which is niche in India, but which is there in the advanced countries like USA or Europe, which does not require too much investment for the young entrepreneurs? Thank you.
You know, today, as I mentioned, it depends which area you want to focus in terms of data analytics. You can just, create data analytics, as I mentioned, for e-tailing. You can create, you can use data analytics for drug research. You can use data analytics for developing software for a driverless car or a robotics or 3D printing or whatever it is. It's up to you. You know, I think entrepreneurs have to figure it out. I mean, there is no a guideline for all entrepreneurs to use data analytics. It's about the concept. I think entrepreneurship is really about creating new ideas from available knowledge, from concepts. You have to visualize it. You have to conceptualize what do you want to use data analytics for as an entrepreneur. Yeah, but I'm not going to tell you that because I'm not here to, give everybody,
Yeah. Okay.
Pardon?
Yeah.
No, it depends. You know, if you want to do something, there is money. I gave you the example of Mu Sigma. They were a small company years ago when data analytics was not fashionable or even known. They somehow managed to raise funding. And data analytics, if you're a computer scientist, you don't have to have a quantum computer to do that today. I mean, you can just use conventional computing power and still focus on coming out with very interesting algorithms.
Thank you for your insights. I'm a PhD student at Delhi University, and I just wanted to get your views on what do you think about academic industry interactions? Like last few years when bioinformatics was the keyword, so a lot of academic groups latched onto this in silico docking and drug designing and computational de novo drug design. But in India, it's just you publish the paper and that's the end of the story. It never actually goes into translation towards industry, or there's no industry academic interaction. So
what's happening today is that many research institutions and universities are starting incubators and accelerators where they're actually encouraging researchers to move ahead with startups. And I think these are also generating a lot of interest from industry. And so we are seeing a lot of startup excitement in this very high technology space, which is actually leading to companies being formed, and those companies then being of great interest to the larger companies. And then the institutes or they also get noticed by big companies saying, hey, this company seems to have a lot of interesting scientists. So let's start partnering with these universities and research institutions. So I really feel that it is beginning to happen. Certainly, you need to be a center of excellence. It's not happening everywhere. But there are centers of excellence all over the country which are beginning to benefit from these incubators, accelerators, and they're beginning to get these connections with industry going.
Hi. I'm a father of a 20-year-old young lady in the top US college and a banker myself. She's doing computational biology out there in a very big way. I want my daughter to come
area.
Back.
Huh? She's in the right area.
I think so too, but I don't understand. And she says, Daddy, there's no chance I can come back here. What do I do? What are the opportunities? How do I get her back?
That's a very good question. I think she should just come here and discover for herself what's happening in the country. And I'm sure she'll change her mind.
Send a CV to Kiran. The left is very subdued, which is not surprising nowadays. But anyway, out here, please.
I loved your interview, the way we started the evening, much before you talked, and very reassuring because of you as a personality. Otherwise, when you look into your lecture and look at it carefully, I find a sense of fear about the manipulation of data. I mean, it was there in the air. Dr. Karnik put it up. It's perhaps because something of the Aadhaar nature, and will it get stolen, and what will happen? Are we now creating what Bernard Shaw talked about, the Superman, in the sense that we're creating a new species and going to leave Indian healing systems and methods out of the way because they are less interventionist in the sense that we believe you can cure yourself. So I work in the area of sociocultural symbiogenesis in the sense that how things naturally evolve. Do you think we need a little more help from people like you to reassure everybody that this is not really a manipulative system we're getting into? How would you do that? How would you reassure people about that? I'm very happy that the banker has a young lady who's deep into it and will come back here. But in the long run, when you have 90-95% of the country, great data, as you said, sampling, great possibility, they might just reject it if we don't have the credibility backing it.
So I think there is something called the ethics of science, and I think we need to propagate that. I think in this country, we don't talk enough about science. We don't educate people about science. We need to have a very, very strong narrative about the ethics of science. We need to have a very large discussion on what science is all about. I think the common man really gets science very wrong. And I think science has really, over the centuries, millions of years, actually, if you think about what science has done for mankind, is amazing. It's just awesome. If you think about, this morning the president actually made a very, very profound statement. He said, when we got our independence, it was we were only 300 million people, and today we are, 1.3 billion people. And it hasn't happened because whether it was the president or somebody else who said it, he said it hasn't happened because we were very happy after independence and therefore produced a lot of kids. It was really because of science. It was about medical science and how it increased the lifespan. So you can see the marvels of science. You can see what science has done for us. I mean, all of us have lived through this enormous exponential technological revolution just in the last couple of decades, right? I mean, I can't imagine that when I was growing up, there was no computer, there was no mobile phone, there was no WhatsApp or Facebook or anything of these things, right? I mean, we grew up with landlines, which hardly worked. We grew up with no TVs. I remember we didn't even have a TV when I was growing up. Today, we can't do without any of these things, right? We almost kind of forget that we actually lived a life without any of these technological interventions. And today, look at how easy our lives have become, thanks to technology. So technology has a huge positive transformational impact on society. And I think that's what we must remember. You know, everyone gets lost in what if this technology would be used for this. Yes, every technology can be misused for a bad purpose. But is that why we shouldn't look at new technology? I think the benefits of technology far outweigh the other side of the misuse of technology. So I think we need to, of course, focus on the ethics of science and technology. We definitely have checks and balances and a lot of regulatory sort of factors which allow us to focus on the good of science. And that's what it's all about.
Good evening, ma'am. It was nice listening, very informative lecture. I've got two things. First question is, you have been very prominent, very successful entrepreneur. To whom do you really attribute your success to, number one? Number two, I would like to have your comments about the spurious medicines being sold in every nook and corner of India. There's a parallel industry running, the turnover of over 20,000 crores annually. Any comments about that? Thank you.
Yeah, so I would say that, you know, in terms of my success, I owe it a lot to a lot of people. I owe a lot to my own colleagues at my company who really have made a lot of what is happening today possible. But I would say, I would also credit my risk-taking ability to some of that success, because I think I have taken risks ahead of time. I have taken risks which nobody was willing to take. So I think taking risks, and I also was willing to fail. I think that the combination of being able to take a risk and, you know, being able to address failure, I think is something that has stood me in good stead, I would say. Coming to your second question, you know, it's a very important question. You're absolutely right. There's a huge problem, but there's a huge innovative solution to that, okay? I think there are a number of solutions which, in fact, I know many companies who are actually addressing spurious drugs and how can you tackle it. So there are companies which are actually developing, it's like a call center. You know, depending on what that spurious drug is, you give a batch number. You know, whatever is on your strip of tablet, you're able to actually call a call center and say, look, this is the batch number I've got on this drug. Is it fake or is it spurious? And you can very quickly know whether it's spurious or not. So these are the kind of things you can actually do. Plus, you know, there are a lot of things like if you really believe a drug is spurious, you know, we were just discussing this evening. In fact, the drugs controller himself was very concerned about spurious drugs, and he was trying to evolve methods where people's doubts could be allayed. And I think they've come up with some very interesting models which, you know, he will share over time. But I think, again, it's about innovation. Technological innovation can actually do away with spurious drugs. And I think we need to use that. And anyone who wants to start a company to address spurious drugs will also do very well.
Okay. Raj?
Kiran, hi. Super lecture and very thought-provoking. You had mentioned the economic survey and India's drive or lack of drive on the patents front. What is the kind of enabling environment you think we would require, or what do you expect the government to do to mine this whole data science and research and innovation that you've been talking about?
So, you know, Raj, we've seen centers of excellence dotted across the country, but at very small scale. Okay, we have great scientists. We have, you know, we've always been, you know, it's one thing is, I think mathematics is in our DNA. I think the Indian DNA is very strong for, you know, centuries in terms of our mathematical prowess. And, you know, some of the greatest mathematicians in this country, well, they've been around for centuries. They've thought in their own, you know, vernacular native languages. So it's not that we borrowed math from outside. Okay, this is very, very a very strong, you know, capability that we have. We have to create capacity around that. I think we don't teach our kids math in the right way. And I think you have to do this in all vernacular schools. Why is it that we don't teach our kids math and the curiosity of math in the way that Ramanujam was fascinated, for that matter? You know, he learnt in Tamil. If you look at all our great mathematicians, they learnt in Sanskrit, in whatever Indian languages that was native to them. But I think somewhere along the line, we've lost that curiosity of knowledge and learning. And we have to bring that passion back into people's minds. Now, I just think, going back to your question, how do we get it all going? I think we need to scale up some of these centers of excellence. So if I want to get into some of these new areas of data science, I think you will see that our Indian Statistical Institute in Calcutta is a phenomenal institute. You've got many of these low-hanging fruits. You know, you've got the ICGB here. You've got the Integrative Biology, Genomic and Biology Center in Delhi. You've got the, you know, the new Center for Theoretical Sciences in Bangalore. You've got so many of these things dotted around. You know, all the IITs themselves are very good at computational work. IISc, of course, has a huge computational, you know, center of excellence. So how do you basically take advantage of what is already there and basically invest in that, create more data scientists, create more infrastructure, and scale up all that? The moment you start creating critical mass, because that's what we miss out on. We have these small, small islands of excellence, but we're not scaling them up. So instead of scaling them up, we'll go and try and create some new institute. I personally believe we should scale up what we already have, because that will grow much faster than trying to start a brand new institute.
Thank you. I know there are more questions, but I'm sorry, we are out of time, and we really need to respect time of each one of you, and certainly of Kiran. I promised her we'd end by 8:30. That was slightly fast, so I'm trying hard to end on time. So thank you for your excellent talk once again, Kiran, and thank you for your patient answers and insight. Let me now hand over to Rakesh to bring the proceedings to a close.
Well, it's been a really fascinating lecture and question answers session. Of course, data science, I personally must confess, I hardly knew anything about it till today evening. So today evening has been a great education for me personally, and I do think it's true for some of the audience, if not a large number. But going beyond data science, the way you gave the exposition and handled the question and answer session, your capacity to take risks, and your responses showed your confidence, optimism, and vision for the future. So young, budding entrepreneurs like Sakshi, I'm sure, would have benefited greatly from your personal experience. Leave aside the details of data science. Let me thank the audience for coming here and asking a range of very interesting questions, some related to data science and some going well beyond it. And that was all interesting. Let me also thank my colleagues in the Habitat Center, both in my office and in the program office. Let me also thank Guljeet, the ever-present, ever-smiling Guljeet, who helped us put this together, along with all the colleagues in ABLE and in Biocon. And I would also like to mention that we've had an excellent series of annual lectures, and each one has been different, and each one has had its own flair. So let me once again at the end thank Mrs. Shaw for a really outstanding evening that we have all thoroughly enjoyed. Thank you.